it's also our speaker's birthday. So happy birthday, GK, again, and thank you very much for joining us and giving us this pleasure on your wonderful day. Thank you. Umesh, over to you, please.
Okay. So let me introduce the speaker of today, Gnanaskandan Keshav Bharathi, more popularly known as GK. He's a passionate birdwatcher, nature enthusiast. He has a keen interest in studying the raptors of South India, and he has anchored several bird survey projects, including the Raptor Watch project a couple of years back for the Madras Naturalist Society. And as we were talking just now, phase two of the project should be starting very soon. GK started his birding during his early college days at his hometown in Tiruvannamalai. The first species that he could identify by himself was the hoopoe. I think something that he shares in common with a lot of us. His birding intensified after he joined MNS in 2008. And two species especially, the Fallows whistling duck and the red-necked falcon, changed the course of his birding in Chennai, because these two were the first two new additions to the Chennai checklist for GK. So obviously his interest picked up, and his keen interest in waders and raptors and the challenges of riding birds led him to go after them much more vigorously in the field after that. Over the years, GK has added 9 notable new species to the Tamil Nadu as well as the Chennai checklist. Besides the two that I already mentioned, Eastern Marsh Harrier, Liger Falcon, Falcated Duck, which is a fantastic record, Small Button Quail, Black-necked Grebe, Dark-sided Flycatcher, Black-breasted Beaver. A whole bunch of records from across various families have been added to the Tamil Nadu checklist thanks to GK. So, you know, he's clearly one of the leading lights of birding in Chennai, and we're all very happy to have him on board today. And as we already mentioned, it is also his birthday, so I'm so happy that he's sharing some of that time with us today. GK, happy birthday again, and over to you.
Thank you so much, Umesh, for a very posh introduction. So, you know, I have to make sure that I meet that expectation that you had set. And, you know, I mean, possibly there could be some mistakes that I would do over the presentation. If there are any, please let me know so that I'll be able to, that will be a chance for me to correct it for the, you know, future presentations and talks. Okay. Thank you so much. Let's get on to the field. Okay. So, quickly on, you know, some of the photographic credits I would like to mention. Because, you know, the pictures that I have taken are from, you know, Oriental bird pics. The reason is because, you know, we wanted to show the best of, you know, each of the species that I'm going to talk about. So I have picked those from the OVIX, and I have given, you know, photographer credits under, you know, each of the pictures. And all the photographs used are, you know, especially exclusively used for educational learning purposes. Since I had not got any, you know, personal email communication over to the photographers, I just wanted, you know, to start with this. And yeah, quickly on the raptor interaction. So raptors are always, you know, fascinating creatures, you know, that everybody, you know, people who are birding, people who are non-birders also love to see raptors. You know, if, you know, when there is, you know, some video playing in some anime, Animal Planet or National Geographic, if something, you know, if people, you know, even non-birders, when they see some hunting, or you know, diving videos, they would, you know, pause a bit, and you know, it captures their eyes. And so to have some kind of introduction, the raptor, the word itself, you know, it has the origin from Latin, which is called raptura, which basically means abduction or capturing a prey by surprise. And all we are going to talk about today are the diurnal birds of prey. And basically, raptors, you know, when we call it as birds of prey, it also includes owls, you know, which are also a bird of prey. But most of the time, the diurnal bird of prey are referred to as raptors in general. And under which we have, you know, two broad categories, the accipitary formers as well as the falconry formers. In accipitary formers, we have, you know, kites, eagles, buzzards, harriers, and vultures. And in falconry forms, the kestrels and falcons will follow. And there is one exception to, you know, when we say raptor, you know, we always think that they are meat eating, but there is one exception, which is a vulture, which is in African Sahara, which is a palm nut vulture, which is actually, which consumes the 50% of its diet is actually the palm nuts and the oil palms. So leaving that one exception, rest of all the raptors that come under the accipitiformes as well as the falconiformes are mostly meat eaters. Okay, possibly, you know, they'll be able to hunt as well as, you know, some of them are rapacious in nature, wherein they'll, you know, take away the prey, you know, from the other raptors and other birds have actually hunted. And overall, in India, so we have close to 72 species which are recorded, you know, plus or minus. And this includes residents, which are resident breeders. And then we also have passage migrants, which pass through the subcontinent to Africa and the other parts. And we also have the wintering migrants who stay put, you know, during the winters months of from October to March. And in this 72 species, you know, close to 40 plus species are found in southern India, out of which 16 are migratory, rest of them are resident breeders. And according to the, you know, especially on the passage migrants and the winter visitors, they usually follow the, you know, Asian, East African flyway. So, they, you know, they start from the north and then they come, you know, into India and they go to Africa. So, you know, the passage migrants mostly move to Africa, especially the Amur falcons as well as the lesser kestrels, but other, you know, stay back in India. Moving on, and a little bit of mythology. So, raptors are associated with humans from, you know, very, very long. And, you know, they have been in the history of India as well as the world. And various literatures, ancient literatures have captured them. And especially, you know, their agility and, you know, their ability to force and then hunt prey have actually created a heroic figure, you know, among the humans. So, probably that could be the reason wherein, you know, most of the mythology and epics as well as Vedas captured, you know, raptors and, in, you know, depicted raptors in various forms. To start with, you know, Jatayu, you know, which is actually the bearded vulture, it has been mentioned in Ramayana as ornamented bird with a goat-like beard, okay, which actually talks about the beard. You know, we also call it as the bearded vulture, right, the lammergeier. So, which is called as a Jatayu, and then we have Garuda, which is a symbol of Vishnu's Vahana, which is actually white-bellied sea eagle. There is a mistake, you know, that people do that, you know, it is actually the Brahminicate, which is referred as Garuda, especially in the Tamil Nadu, but it is actually not. It is the white-bellied sea eagle, you know, who is referred as Garuda. And Suparna, which is actually been mentioned in Rig Veda, the golden eagle is referred as Suparna, which means that the king of all the eagles. And they have also went into a state and mentioned that, you know, the broad chested and, you know, big wings, and you know, it can hunt any bird and animal of any size. That's the reason they call it as a king of the eagles. And you know, we have to you know, we have to see how good the observations are made even in those days. And Shiprachayana is a word you know, in Sanskrit too, which refers to Shaheen falcon. The, you know, the reddish, rusty reddish belly of the Shaheen falcon actually been represented here as Shiprachayana, and also it is called as the lion of the birds, or the tiger of the birds, basically referred to the speed in which, you know, they are able to capture the prey, the speed in which they are able to dive. You know, it represents both Shaheen falcon as well as the migrating peregrine falcon. And falconry has been you know, in the tradition in India for very old days. In the initial days, actually, falconry been used especially to hunt, you know, they trained falcons and other birds in order to hunt other birds only for the meat. Only when the Mughal kings came over, falconry actually been become a sport at that time. The Mughal kings are very, very, you know, popular for, you know, falconry, right from, you know, starting from Akbar, who had a very, very big, you know, collection of falcons. And followed by that, Shah Jahan also had a big, you know, falconry, and he is the one who is supposed to have 50 plus birds with him, you know, 50 plus raptors with him over a period, you know, of different species. Okay? And one notable sighting is the Jir falcon. So Shah Jahan used to have a Jir falcon that he received from one of the Shah from Persia. Okay, that, you know, Jir falcon is, you know, one of the birds which looks more like a snowy owl, which is, you know, more white in color, and it is, you know, not everybody, many people had the Jir falcon during that time. So when Shah Jahan had it, he lost the bird, and it was captured by Har Gobind Singh, who was one of the kings there. And then what happened was he took the possession of the Gir falcon, and in order to get that, Shah Jahan actually, made a small war. I'll not say war, a small fight with, picked up fight with Har Gobind Singh for a couple of times, but then he gave up, for a later point of time. And so basically, they are there with us for so long, in different aspects. And the national symbols and monuments, many of the countries have raptors mentioned over in their monuments, and then, in a great symbol of in the flags, things like that. So they are there for very long. Okay. So what to watch, when we look at raptors, observe raptors, there are a few things that we have to consider, when we look forward for them, not just, looking out for the birds. Considering these, the points that I'm going to mention, 50% of the bird identification can just be done. Raptor identification can be just done by, watching this, checklist. First and foremost is the habitat preference. Each raptor have a habitat, preference. There are multiple. See, raptors are found in diverse habitats. Lake beds, and then water bodies, and then deserts, and then dry deciduous forests, woodlands, everywhere. They are pretty much spread out everywhere in across all the habitats. So, and each raptor, according to their prey that they prefer, they also have a preference to the habitat. So by looking at the habitats, you'll be able to 50% of the time you'll be able to 50% of the raptor species you'll be able to eliminate while you're identifying a raptor, especially let's say a peregrine falcon or a great-eyed spotted eagle have a preference to stay closer to the wetland, and whereas a lugger falcon loves more arid as well as deserted more drier regions, things like that. And the short-tailed snake will prefer an open habitat, wherein a crested serpent eagle is also a snake slayer, but it prefers a different, woodland as well as forest habitat. So by knowing the habitat, we'll be able to, we will know, what kind of raptors we can actually see in that habitat. Next one is the prey. Again, there are prey, the preferred raptors prefer prey, especially peregrines and other falcons, they prey on birds, short-toed snake eagle, as well as the crested serpent eagle, they prefer snakes, things like that. So by knowing their prey, you'll know, where you can expect a particular raptor to turn. And harriers, that they love insects and they prefer grasslands and where the insects are abundant. Behavior routine. And each raptor will have a behavior routine, right from starting their day till ending their day. So smaller birds like, falcons and accipiters, they tend to start their day a little early. Especially the falcons, some of the falcons are crepuscular in nature. They hunt during a early day, and then, during the dawn and dusk. And then the other raptors, like, the bigger raptors, especially eagles, who mostly soar and then glide, and they rely on thermals for most of the time. They start the day a little late because they will wait for the thermals to start, the sun to be out. And by knowing the behavior routine, also you'll know, which birds you can expect during that time for the particular hour of the day. And also some of the species like, peregrine and shaheen have a behavior of taking a bath, taking a dip on a daily basis. So the moment they get up, they stretch out, and then they head out most of the time, I will say, the typical routine. And they take a bath. So these are the behavioral routines that we have to keep in mind when we are watching a raptor. Perch and posture. This is another important thing for bird identification. And I'll talk about the posture first. So some raptors prefer horizontal posture, and then some of them prefer vertical posture. So by looking at that and by getting a proper structure, we'll be able to identify. And perch, these days we don't have many of the trees around, and most of the raptors, except probably harriers, most of the raptors prefer electric pylons and then mobile towers. These days, those were their perch options, wherein they'll be able to have a very good bird eyes view, and then they'll be able to hunt as well as they'll be able to look out for the surroundings. So each raptor will they have a preference. You know, this is from a field observations. Even in the electric pylon, you know, they have a specific perch preferences. Peregrines and redneck falcons used to, you know, sit very high, you know, on the pylons, wherein the spotted eagles, they sit, you know, at the lowest bases of the pylons. And then the white-eyed buzzards as well as kestrels, they don't prefer to sit in the, you know, base of the pylon, but then they'll sit in the edges, you know, there'll be some kind of nails kind of structure in the side of the pylons. They prefer to sit there. And ospreys and short-toed snake eagles particularly, they always alight on the very much top of the pylon. You know, if the pylon, you know, if it is like this, ends with a triangle at the top, you know, they always alight at the top of the triangle. You know, these are basic observations, you know, that we have got. So they always, from multiple observations, we saw that, you know, they always prefer to perch in these areas, you know, of the different pylons. And flight characteristics. This is again very important, especially most of the time we see raptors in flight rather than they are perched. And it is very important for us to understand the flight characteristic. So, you know, something which is gliding just over a blade of grass, you know, will mostly be an harrier. And, you know, something which is hovering, a big bird which is hovering could be a short-toed snake eagle. And something which is dashing and which has a parabolic or boomerang kind of shape could be any of the falcons, you know, things like that. So, all these things put together, you know, if you know these five checklist or the pointers that I have mentioned, 50% of the raptors can be identified just by this. Moving more, so why are, you know, raptors important? You know, they are the top key of the, you know, food chain. So they are, you know, proper indicators of what is the health of a particular habitat on the ecosystem is. They being the root of the food cycle. You know, if based on the raptors, in the number of raptors or the population of raptors, we'll be able to see how good that ecosystem is doing. And they also keep a check on the number of rodent, insect and, you know, reptile population around. And they also clean up carrion. You know, there was one study wherein they have mentioned that the crows and the blackcaps, they clean up, you know, 50% of the decaying vegetable as well as animal matter. You know, in the cities, in the metropolitan cities. So, which means that, you know, how much they are helping us out. So, they are pretty much important for us. And a couple of points that I missed, you know, that I would like to mention are, you know, those are interesting points. I don't want to miss it out. So, there are raptors which are actually being, you know, consumed by, you know, people as well. So, there is one section of people in New Guinea, you know, who have that taste buds towards ospreys. So, you know, they hunt ospreys for the taste. And also, as you know, people have been hunting Amur falcons in Naga for years. And then, you know, Conservation India and team chipped in and do a lot, you know, did a lot of awareness across India and also across, you know, the Naga people. And we were able to save, you know, the Amur falcons. And there was one section of people called Badas in Andhra Pradesh. Who had actually had a taste of the vultures. So they were actually, you know, consuming vultures during the 1990s, you know, wherein, you know, there was a dip in, you know, the diclofenac thing happened and there was a dip in vultures. And these people were consuming the vultures. And on the other side, you know, there were also raptors which were actually consuming the humans. So which means that basically these are some of the people who had, especially the Parsis, they had a habit of giving away the dead in the open for vultures to feed on, and they construct, you know, I think I remember reading somewhere where there is some kind of construction which is there in around Mumbai, you know, wherein they leave out the dead and then vultures used to, you know, eat from there. And the Tibetans also had a similar habit of, you know, they will take the dead to the higher mountains and then they'll leave it out for the vultures to eat, and then they collect the bones and then do the rituals. So things like that. So the raptors are always, you know, with us for, you know, quite a long time, and, you know, it continues. Moving on. So why raptors? You know, why do we love raptors? So the reason they are fascinating because they are powerful, their agility in flight, and the strength they show, you know, in order to abduct the prey and capture the prey. And these are some things that we get fascinated about raptors. And in order to do that, in order to fly like this, in order to capture the prey, they have multiple adaptations. We're going to see some of the adaptations here. Starting with the baffle, the nostril baffle. This is specific, very specific to the falcons. Okay, baffles are small projecting bone-like structure in the nostril, which actually help them breathe with these. So as falcons dive at a greater speed, when the air goes in directly into the lungs, it can affect the lungs. So they have a bony structure in the nostrils. It's a conical bone. What it does is it makes the air go in a circular motion, which slows down the air, especially during hunting dives. Next one is the fovea. So fovea are depressions in behind our eyes, where the photoreceptors are at the highest. Okay, humans have just one single fovea, wherein raptors have two fovea. One is a shallow fovea, other one is a deep fovea. In order to get the binocular vision, they use the shallow fovea, wherein they'll be able to look at straight and they'll be able to see it. And the deeper fovea is in a different angle. That's the reason when they want to use the deeper fovea, they will tilt their head little bit at an angle of 45 degrees, and then they'll be able to see objects that are at a very longer distance. And especially when we talk about fovea, raptors have 5 times the extra vision compared to humans. At the foveas, the photoreceptors that we have are close to 2 lakh photoreceptors per square millimeter, wherein they have 10 lakh photoreceptors per square millimeter. So they'll be able to see, especially they'll be able to see it in a much better in photographic terms, I'll say much better clarity. So the higher the megapixel, the 5 times the better megapixel that they have in the right side. The supraorbital ridge. So this is I don't know whether you'll be able to see the mouse pointer. So this is a supraorbital ridge. It is a bony structure. Even we have a bony structure here. Similar to that, raptors also have a supraorbital ridge, which actually shades the eye. It is a bone, protruding bone on their skull, which actually shades the eye, so that it gives a shade for them to look at. Of course, the talons. This is the killing machine for their any raptors. And they have very strong talons, which with that they'll be able to grab the prey, hold the prey. And you also see something called nodules. Just below the feet, they have small projections, which are called nodules, which actually help them grip the prey. And especially when you see here, this portion is called a tibia portion, and it differs between different raptors. So looking at the tibia also, we'll be able to guess what raptor, at some extent what raptor it is. So some of them have bare tarsi and tibia. And here if you see the tarsi, it is slightly feathered, but most of the tarsi is bare. And especially things like the short-toed snake eagle, especially the raptors which hunt snakes, they have a very scaly tibia, as well as the raptors that hunt fishes, they also have a scaly tibia and tarsi. And for some of the eagles, especially the aquilas, the spotted eagles, as well as some other eagles, they have a feathered tarsi, wherein the entire tarsi is feathered. Yeah, this is another interesting feature that the raptors have. This portion, what you see just in the upper mandible, it's called a tomial tooth. Okay, this helps in tearing out flesh, as well as it also helps and there is a notch in the lower mandible. This actually goes and lies over the notch in the lower mandible, which the falcons use especially in order to kill their prey. So they'll put the beak inside the vertebrae of the prey, and then using this tomial tooth, they'll just twitch it so that they'll break the spinal cord of the prey, and they'll be able to kill the prey. This is especially done observed in the falcons. The last one is the facial ruff. This is there for some of the raptor group, especially in harriers. Harriers, hunt also by their listening, because they always look for small insects like grasshoppers, locusts in the grass, wearing thick grass. Okay, so they'll not be able to see the prey, so they also would like to hear. They'll look for small rustles within the grass, and then they'll be able to capture the prey. For that, they have a face, facial ruff. These are semicircular feathers that are around their head, which actually they'll be able to lift as well as, close when needed. And this actually will be able to, at certain extents, not as good as owls, but to up to certain extents, they'll be able to gather it. It looks, it acts as a parabola, wherein they'll be able to gather the sound and, it directly gets into their ears. So, and also, the honey buzzards also have some kind of, facial ruff, wherein they have very, very tough feathers, over the face in order to help them, save the bee and the wasp stings, they consume over. Okay, coming over to a little bit of, raptor identification. So what we are going to see now going forward is, as I already mentioned, most of the time we see raptors in flight, okay, rather than they perch. So it is very important for us to understand, how they look structurally. So once you know the structure and then the shape of the raptor, it is very easy for us to eliminate, most of the other species and concentrate on the species that we have actually seen. Okay. For that, I put a collection of, different species here. And this is, if you can even find out or identify a group, for which the particular raptor belongs to, by looking at the shape, that itself is good. Not every time we'll be able to identify the raptors, the exact species of the raptors. They being very fast, and then they'll be flying very far, things like that. And raptors come in various forms, different shapes, different sizes, different plumages. And within a single species, there will be multiple plumages when they are molting. The juveniles will be completely different, and the adults will be completely different. So things like that. Identifying a raptor is always a challenge, and it is always an art that we have to learn it in the field. So all that I am going to talk here are tips that you can help you in the field, and after that it is going to be art, the art that you are going to carry it in your own fashion as well as in your own style. So what you see here is the different raptors here, and then so this is a picture wherein this is up to scale. This is actually an Indian vulture. This is up to scale. According to that, I have aligned the rest of the raptors so that you'll be able to see what size each one of them is. Starting with, accipiters, shikras, Eurasian sparrow hawks, crested bush hawks. These are, these form under the accipiter category. They are basically, they have bulgy secondaries and then, a rounded fingers or rounded wings, the flight feathers, and a long tail, and a very short projection of the head. So these are mostly birds which actually perch and then hunt by surprise. And most of them, most of the active accipiters hunt within the canopy or within the woodland, things like that. So they have this rounded, rounded feathers or rounded wings, which will help them, fly between, this is a robust structure wherein they'll be able to fly between, different objects, within the canopy. And the next one are the falcons, the typical, triangular wing shape and very strong head because of the very strong beak and, a boomerang kind of shape and with a long tail. And of course, they have long feathers, the long wings as well as the long tail, which help them maneuver. And the next one are the harriers. They have the lowest wing loading because they wanted to fly very slow over the grass, and then they wanted to capture the insects and other locusts. So they have very low wing loading. That's the reason they have very long tail as well as, compared to their body, they have very long wing shape. Next one is the buzzard, the buteos. So these are typical buzzards wherein you'll be able to see the bulging secondaries. These are slightly bigger than our black-eyes and slightly, not a big tail, compact tail, which is a fan, and then a compact head. These are buzzards. And of course, the black-eyed. The reason I put the black-eyed here is for the comparison. So accipiters, falcons, as well as harriers are more or less less than a kite size, when the rest of them in this group are, bigger than a black-eyed. Blackhead is a very common raptors. That's the reason it is easy for us to compare it. And the other one that we can, you know, usually compare is house crow. We know the size of the house crow. And most of the raptors are more or less smaller, slightly smaller and, you know, bigger than the house crow. So we'll be able to easily map them. You know, there is a benchmark wherein, you know, we'll be able to see how, you know, while we see them in the flight. And of course, the vultures, which have a very long wingspan, and they also have, you know, protruding fingers. We call these primaries as fingers, and then, you know, very long tail, and also they have a protruding head. And the last one of the eagles, this includes the Aquila eagles. And you can see that, you know, the very triangular wing shape, not so bulging secondaries, but then a very long wing panel, and not so protruding head as well as the tail, and very prominent the primaries. Yeah. And the last one here is the honey buzzard as well as the hawk eagles. They have a very long tail and the bulging secondaries, and they also show very prominent fingers, and the head is kind of, you know, small head, but then a projecting head. So by knowing these shapes, you know, as well as the size, the reason we mentioned the size as well as shape is it will be easy for us to identify what raptor we are seeing in the field. Even if it is in a silo, even if we are not able to identify the exact species, we'll be able to put them under a group, you know, these group, you know, whether it is an accipiter, falcon or harrier, buzzard or a vulture or an eagle. Moving on, I want to capture, you know, some of the topography, you know, so that, you know, we'll know when we talk about raptors, we need to know, you know, what each part is, so that we'll be able to correlate with, you know, when we go for the identification part. I mean, these are the primaries. The secondaries and primaries are put together as the flight feathers. And as you know, the primaries will always be pointing outside, and the secondaries will always be pointing in, you know, towards the bird. And also the primaries, you know, usually they'll say the raptors have 10 primaries starting from P1. The inner bird primary is P1, and starting to that we'll have up to P10. The outermost primary is P10. And secondaries, again, from the smaller raptors will have from 1 to 12 secondaries. And then wherein the bigger raptors with the bigger wing panel, like the vultures, have, you know, close to 15 to 20 secondaries as well. And the one, you know, the front forward wing panel is called leading edge, and the backward wing panel is called a trailing edge, which actually helps us especially in identifying raptors by looking at the trailing edge as well as the leading edge. And this portion is called a carpal, and this is called a carpal joint, and this portion is called a carpal, and this entire portion is called a covert. Basically, this also helps us in order to understand, you know, some of the raptors show darker carpals like the Buteos, and then some of the raptors like the Bonalis eagle as well as the Rufous-bellied eagle show, you know, much darker entire covert. So it is very important for us to understand that. Next one is to understand the tail topography as well, because most of my talk is going to be on, you know, with the tail, identifying raptors by looking at the shape as well as the tail. So it is very important to understand, you know, what each of this topography of the tail is. So the lowermost portion in the tail is called a terminal band, which is usually a very thin band compared to the subterminal band. The one that is following is a subterminal band, which is always, in most of the raptors, the subterminal band is wider, followed by the multiple, you know, tail borings. This is very important because the rest of the talk that I'm going to have is mostly, you know, on the tail. I'm quickly checking the time. So, okay, I'll go forward a little bit quickly. Okay, these are the different, you know, tails that we see in raptors. A bigger subterminal band, broader subterminal band, followed by a very, very wide, you know, wide tail band. And the next one is a broad subterminal band, whereas the smaller wide panel. And then equally barred tail feathers. And then this is more a gray tail, but then followed by a very, very, very indistinct black subterminal band. Again, here, a gray tail followed by a very broad subterminal, conspicuous subterminal band. Of course, we know this is of the kite, which is a fork tail. And then here, again, we have a gray tail with a very prominent subterminal band. And this is a tail wherein it has a equally barred, you know, black and white terminal bands. So how these are going to help us? So with this, you know, if you know these tail bands, we'll be able to identify by the shape and, I mean, first comes the shape and size. But if you know these terminal bands, we'll be able to identify close to 16 different species. Let me go over to that. Okay. Size of a black kite, a raptor which is the size of a black kite and which has a very, very, you know, thick, you know, black terminal band followed by a grayish or whitish, palish band, okay. This is available only for two raptors. If you observe a very, you know, very wide band, black band and double the size of the black band, a gray or a pale band, only two raptors possess this, which are actually the oriental honey buzzard as well as the crested hawk eagle. None of the other raptors show, I mean, when I say these are typical adults, all I am talking about is typical adults. There are multiple morphs, as I already mentioned, and also juveniles will look different. Typical adults of these two species are the only ones which show a broad subterminal band, dark band, followed by a pale band which is twice the size of the dark subterminal band. So as you can see here clearly on the left are the honey buzzards. The one is a male, the other one is a female, but you can see clearly the subterminal band is dark, broad, but then the next band which is going to be twice the size of this terminal band. And again in crested hawk eagles, very much the same. One other thing that we have to observe is most of the raptors, they follow the, I mean, when you look at the tail band, you follow the same pattern in the wing panel also. Now that you have these two raptors identified, you know, just by looking at this tail, you will be able to identify these two raptors. How are you going to put this out, you know, which one is the crested hawk eagle and which one is the honey buzzard? It's a very simple formula. Honey buzzards have their feet extending only till the starting of their tail, as you can see here, as well as here, wherein the crested hawk eagle, the feet will extend till the mid of the tail. So if you see a tail band like this, the next moment all you have to look at is, you know, where the feet ends. If the feet ends right, you know, next to the, you know, tail band, or if the feel, tail, the feet extends till the mid of the tail band, it is going to be crested hawk eagle. If it is going to be a shot, and it is going to be honey buzzard. These are, I mean, all that I am covering are typical adults of each of the species. The next one is a broad subterminal band followed by a pale band, which is shorter than the subterminal band. And you also see same in the wing panel as well. This is a black kite plus size bird. Again, by looking at this, this is the only species which has this subterminal band followed by a pale band, but the subterminal band is much bigger than the pale band. The species is crested serpent eagle. It's pretty straightforward. This is the only species that shows this kind of pattern both in the tail as well as in the wing. Moving on. Next one is the short-haired snake eagle. As you can see, the tail pattern, it has all white tail, all pale tail with a broad subterminal band. But after that, it is a equally spread out black bands. And it is a black kite plus size bird. As you can see, all the short-haired snake eagles, including the juveniles, will clearly show all pale tail with a broad subterminal band, followed by, you know, multiple, small tail bands. Again, this will be exactly same as in the wing panel as well. And most of the time, you see them, hovering in a height. And this is the biggest hovering bird that we see. So it is very easy. A pale hovering bird with, this kind of tail barring will be able to eliminate most of the raptors out, and it is going to be a short-haired snake eagle. Also, you'll be able to see a very darker head, which is, again, are going to be a diagnostic feature. I'm going a bit fast, by looking at the time. Umesh and Srikanth, do we have any time zone here?
Yes, not to worry. We don't have any time limit on Zoom.
Okay, thank you so much, Srikanth.
Yeah.
Okay, next one is, a very interesting rapper and, one of my favorite rappers. So, as you see, a completely gray tail, okay, and then the feet is extending till the mid of the tail, and the tarsi is closely feathered. Okay, there are only two species of raptors which show these kind of tail, wherein a gray tail and a subterminal band with a very thin black bands, only seen in two eagles. One is a forest eagle, and another one is open country eagle. The first one is the Bonelli's eagle, as you see. It has a feathered tarsi. And again, as I already mentioned, the tail, whatever the pattern that you see in the tail, it also shows up in the wing panel as well. Another diagnostic feature of the Bonelli's eagle is the darker underwing coverts. So, no other raptors will show this dark underwing coverts, which actually contrast with the flight feathers. And moving over, this is a black kite plus size bird, wherein there is another bird that we are going to see, which is a forest eagle, which also shows a very similar tail band, but it is very diagnostic, which is actually a black kite size bird, which is a rufous bellied eagle, which also shows a similar kind of tail. But then we'll be able to distinguish between them just by habitat, because this is a proper forest eagle, wherein Bonelli's eagle is also seen in the forest, closer to the forest, but then mostly it is an open country raptor. And the diagnostic feature of the white throat, as well as the ear mask or the ear covers, the mask that the rufous bellied wears, are the diagnostic feature of the rufous bellied eagle. So when you see this kind of tail pattern, as well as a feathered tarsi, that is also important, feathered tarsi, that is going to be lead to two different species, which is going to be a Bonelli's eagle as well as a rufous bellied eagle. The interesting factor is that I would like to mention is especially today being Father's Day, I wish everybody here a happy Father's Day. And there are two species that are very close to my heart, which actually shows this tail pattern. One is an eagle, which of course is the Bonelli's eagle. The other one is a redneck falcon. What is the significance that they have on the Father's Day is other raptors, most of the other raptors, they'll be going along with the females only during the breeding season. But especially the Bonelli's eagle as well as the redneck falcon along with the lagger falcon, it is not only during the pair bonding you'll be able to see, or during the nesting stage you'll be able to see them together. Once the pair gets bonded, Bonelli's eagle, redneck falcon, as well as the lagger falcon, they will always be together all around the year. All along the year, irrespective of whether it is a breeding season or outside the breeding season. So with them, these Bonelli's eagle sharing, everything with the female of the species. So I thought, these two are very significant, especially needs to be quoted on the Father's Day. Okay, the next one is a black kite size bird. This is very important for us to understand. A very grayish tail and diagnostic terminal band. Very, very light terminal band and the multiple tail band and feather tarsi. Okay, the reason I wanted to mention this is actually of a booted eagle. The darker morph, the paler morph is very diagnostic, we'll be able to easily find it out in the field. But then the dark morph is, as it is black kite size, it can be confused with a black kite. Not every black kite shows the forked tail. So some of the, while in molting, they may not be showing the forked tail. So the main diagnostic feature where we can put a black kite and a booted eagle is are the feathered tarsi, wherein the black kite shows a bad tarsi, and then the tail, which is all gray tail. Wherein in black kites, it is all brown tail with very thin white bands in the tail. This is all gray tail. See, as you can see here, there are no markings in the tail. It's all gray tail. Wherein here, it is showing all gray tail along with the markings, along with the subterminal band. So it is not a rule that always it shows a subterminal band. It could be plain like this as well. And the other diagnostic feature which may or may not be seen in the field are we call it the bullets. So at this shoulder patch, the booted eagle show a white patch which can be seen when the eagle flies directly towards us. Coming to the Brahmini kite, this is the only raptor which shows all red tail with a kind of rounded tail, and also very specific very conspicuous reddish brown undertail covers. No other raptor shows it, so which is very straightforward. And again the blackade. So blackade, most of the time it shows a fork tail. I mean, good that the most common occurring raptor, especially in the cities as well as the villages and around. So it is very important. We have to thank God that it has a fork tail, so that we'll be directly able to eliminate. Otherwise, most of us will be going behind it, looking at it is some other Aquila eagle or a booted eagle, things like that. So by looking at the fork tail, we'll be able to eliminate that it's a black eye. But we have to pay a little bit attention, because some of the raptors, when they are molting, when the tail feathers, which are at the center tail feathers, while they are in the molting stage, they look a little bit of fork. So we should not be fooled by that. And black eyed, as as I already mentioned, will have a brownish gray tail, wherein the barrings will be very very equally barred. Now moving over to the falcons. One thing I would like to mention is as I was mentioning about the father day species, right? So the Bonelli's eagle as well as the redneck falcon, what they share in common, the behavior that I mentioned, they once they get paired, they always be with their female partners even outside the breeding season. There is another thing that they have in common by look is the tail. Okay, both of them have a gray tail followed by a thicker subterminal band with a multiple tail barring, black tail barring, very thin tail barring. So they share in this in common, fortunately. And then so in falcons, let's say a house crow minus bird, when you see a house crow minus bird with a very prominent subterminal band followed by a gray tail with very thin banding, and it's a house crow minus bird size bird, it can be of three species: redneck falcon, common kestrel, as well as the lesser kestrel. Redneck falcon is will not miss it, because the reddish head is very 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 diagnostic in the field, and they also have the barring. So when we see this tail barring and it is a house crow minus bird, the next moment we have to look at is the wing panel. So, and as well as the belly, it is a equally barred, thinly barred belly. Otherwise it is all white, and the white throat as well as white upper breast. And this red head is very 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 conspicuous in the field. But most of the time the redneck falcons, you will not be seeing up in the sky like the other raptors. They always fly very close to the ground, and mostly they feed on ground nesting or smaller birds like sparrow sized birds, like pipits. Mostly they hunt sparrow plus sized birds which actually perch on the ground. So usually you will see them flying closer to the ground, and they are very very diagnostic. They'll most of the time they'll be in pairs. You'll definitely will not be mistaking it in the field with any other raptor. Okay, next one is which has a similar tail barring, or the common as well as the lesser kestrels. First we'll look at the, and it is very 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 tough for us to put the common kestrel as the lesser kestrel in the field, unless you know we have some of the diagnostic features that are visible. Otherwise, you know, we have to term it as stamp it as a kestrel most of the time. So the one that you see here are the male kestrels, common as well as lesser. The left one is the lesser kestrel, and the right one is the common kestrel. Lesser kestrel, it is more planar, you know, underwing, whereas the common kestrel mostly shows a lot of barring, as well as the eye stripe. You know, the lesser kestrel doesn't show eye stripe, and it has a very plain gray head, wherein a common kestrel also has a plain gray head, but then the eye stripe as well as the mustachial stripe are very, very, very constant, you know, diagnostic, as well as it will have a lot of, you know, barring in the belly, wherein the barring will be completely missing in a lesser kestrel. And lesser kestrels are, you know, usually gregarious. Usually you will see them in groups, whereas the common kestrel, even in the wintering grounds, they are very, very territorial, even with the conspecifics. So they'll be always alone. And the other thing that you can also see is the lesser kestrels are more agile while they hover. You know, both of them hunt by hovering. Okay. And I cannot say that, you know, it is a diagnostic key ID feature, but what we have observed in the field is the common kestrel usually hovers very parallel to the ground, wherein the lesser kestrel will have, you know, slightly angled hovering, which we have actually observed that in the field. But it is not a very diagnostic feature. We will not be able to go with that, but it is one thing that we have observed in common. And on the females, again, on the left-hand side, it's a lesser kestrel female. On the right-hand side, it's a common kestrel. As you can clearly see, the lesser kestrel female is not showing any diagnostic eye stripe or mustachial stripe, wherein the common kestrel will show a very diagnostic eye stripe. And as I already mentioned, the lesser kestrel will show a more paler wing panel, flight feathers, wherein the less, common kestrel, it shows a lot of barring. Other than this, you know, when perched, you'll be also able to see the wing and tail ratio when they are perched. Okay? And for lesser kestrels, the wing will reach almost till the edge of the tail, wherein in common kestrel, it falls, you know, right behind the subterminal band itself. And one another feature that you know, the field guides mention are the claw. Okay, lesser kestrels used to show a paler claw, wherein the common kestrels used to show a dark claw. But again, this feature, you know, we cannot take it completely, because there was a common kestrel in Gujarat which has been identified with the pale claw. So we'll not be able to go with the claw as an identifier. Moving on, other falcons which actually show evenly barred tail, and they are a house crow minus size. There are only two falcons that actually show this kind of tail pattern. There are Amur falcons as well as the Eurasian hobby. Okay, Amur falcon male is very diagnostic. Will not be able to miss it out. It has all gray body with you know, orangish feet as well as orangish eyes, and a very diagnostic white carpal patches. Or sorry, wing covers, under wing covers. The female can be confused with, you know, females as well as juveniles can be confused with Eurasian hobbies. But then one feature, I'll say two features that keep them apart is the beak that is actually orange, as well as the feet that is orange, as well as the trailing edge. So this is where, you know, the trailing edge comes into picture. Very, very dark and broad trailing edge. You will not be able to see this feature in any of the other falcons. So when you see a falcon with a very, very diagnostic broad trailing edge, which goes till the outer primaries, and which has an orange feet as well as an orange beak, it has to be an Amur falcon. And again, Amur falcons are very good hoverers. They hover very much, I mean, while they migrate, they go along with lesser kestrels, because, you know, both of them migrate towards Africa, and they do a passage migration. I mean, they are passage migrants to India. and both of them hovers, and the hovering of the Amur Falcon is not so long. You know, they hover only for a very, very short time frame, and then they'll keep, you know, switching their paces, and they'll keep hovering. And the one below is the Eurasian Hobby. Again, the Eurasian Hobby will show a very long wing panel compared to that of the Amur Falcon. Amur Falcons show a very thick wing panel with a very broad shoulders, wherein Eurasian Hobby will show very long wing panel. And the another diagnostic feature are the thighs, okay, the rusty thighs, as well as the mustachial stripe. Very, very diagnostic mustachial stripe, as well as there will be one more stripe near the eye, which is one which happens only for which is visible only for the Eurasian Hobbies. As you can see, you know, this is a female Amur Falcon. This is a juvenile Eurasian Hobby. Even though the tail are barred, you know, distinctly barred, they are barred in a different way. If you can, you know, observe closely, in the Amur Falcon, the black bands will be thinner, okay, wherein in the Eurasian Hobby, the white bands, tail bands will be thinner. Or sometimes they'll be of the equal size in Eurasian Hobby, the black and the white bands. Mostly it is thin, the white bands are thin, but in some of the cases, they'll be of the equal size. But in a Amur Falcon females, the black bands are always thinner, wherein the gray bands are wider. So this is how we'll be able to put, you know, just by looking at the tail, you know, just by looking at this tail, we'll be able to know this has a very thin white bars, wherein the black bars are wider. So this is of a Eurasian Hobby. Moving on. So falcons, which are house crow plus size, again, have a gray tail with a proper equal amount of barring, black bar, black and gray barrings. Only two falcons, you know, show this diagnostic feature, which are, of course, you know, crow plus size birds. One is the peregrine falcon, the other one is the lagger falcon. We can put out, you know, lagger and peregrine falcon, we can easily distinguish, because lagger falcon shows a very, very dark underwing coverts, as well as it will show streaking. Wherein a peregrine, the underwing coverts are not so dark, but then it will not show a streaking, but then it will show a barring in the underbelly. This is very diagnostic, you know, in flight for both a peregrine falcon as well as a lagger falcon. Wherein in case of juveniles, you know, they look pretty much the same at a distance. You know, if they are, you know, backlit, you will not be able to see if the underwing coverts are darker than the wing, the flight feathers. You will not be able to see it. But there is another feature that actually helps us identify a juvenile lagger falcon over a peregrine falcon are the feet. Peregrine falcons show a very, very yellow feet, yellowish feet, wherein the lagger falcon, it is grayish blue. And also the seer, if you see, the seer is the one that just above the peregrine falcon's beak is yellow, wherein the seer of the lagger falcon is bluish gray. So with these features, we'll be able to distinguish between a juvenile of a lagger falcon and peregrine falcon. Moving over, so we are done with the, you know, tail, wherein we were able to identify a list of raptors just by looking at the tail and the shape. And now moving over to the harriers, we will not be able to identify harriers just by looking at the tail. And there is more towards harriers. So now we are switching over to the wing panel. So by looking at the wing panel, we are going to identify harriers. So the commonly occurring harriers I'm portraying here, the pied harrier, Montagu's harrier, as well as the pilot harrier. Pied harrier, very diagnostic, overall a white bird, and you know, all black hand. And one thing which the harriers share in common are the black hand. You know, all the male harriers will have a black hand, you know, be it the Montagu's or the pied or the pilot harrier. So pilot harrier, as you know, it's very diagnostic, you know, black head and overall white body. Moving on to the Montagu's harrier, it is a slaty blue-gray bird with black hand. But then this is the only harrier which shows, you know, lot of brownish dots as well as brown streaking in the body as well as the underwing coverts. And palate area is pretty straightforward, all white bird, you know, and then no diagnostic feature in the belly or in the coverts. It is all pale white with a prominent prominent black hand. So it is very easy to distinguish, you know, male harriers. Now comes the tricky part, the females. In flight, all the females of pied, Montagu and pallid harriers look pretty much similar, but there are certain features which will actually put them apart. Starting with the pied harrier female, okay? And if you see the pied, you know, when you see a harrier, especially if it is a female or a juvenile, what you have to do is you have to give, you know, observe their actually the wing panel. That is where you have to concentrate. So you see the trailing edge, which a dark trailing edge, which goes till the outer primaries and the barred outer primary fingers. This is a very, very diagnostic feature of the female pied harrier. Along with that, it is not just that. The other barrings in the flight feathers, the secondaries as well as primaries, will be very, very, very feeble. When you compare it, the barrings, you know, in the flight feathers, that is the base of the primaries as well as the secondaries, when you compare it with the Montagu's harrier as well as the pallid harrier, they are very, very diagnostic. Wherein in the pied harrier, it will be very, very feeble. And also, as I already mentioned, the trailing edge, dark trailing edge, which goes till the outer primaries, and the outer primaries are evenly barred. That's a diagnostic feature of a pied harrier female. Coming to the Montagu's and pallid harrier, you know, these are the most encountered harriers of our region. So how do we, you know, put them apart? Again, we have to concentrate at the wing region. As you see, then in the Montagu harrier female, you have the trailing edge goes till up to the outer primaries, wherein in the pallid harrier, it stops once the secondary is over, and at the primary 1 to 4 or 1 to 5, it will not show any dark trailing patch, but then again, it will you know, go on for the outer primaries. Both for Montagu harrier as well as the pallid harrier, the hand or the outer primaries are equally barred, but then this is a diagnostic feature, as well as the white panel, you know, which is just after the trailing edge, the white wing panel, it goes till the edge of the body for a Montagu's harrier, wherein it is very, very, it becomes very feeble when it reaches a secondary. You know, here it will be very diagnostic till the outer primary, sorry, the inner primaries. When it reaches a secondaries, it will be very, very feeble and it stops there. Wherein it goes on till the body for a Montagu's harrier. And the other diagnostic feature are the collar. Pallid harriers show very, very, very prominent pale collar, wherein this is not very diagnostic in the Montagu's harrier. So by looking at the wing panel and looking at, I mean, the tail, you know, most of the harriers show pretty much this, you know, similar tail. So I'm not going to go over there. So whenever you identify that it is a raptor which is flying, it is very important for us to, you know, look at the wing panel. And most of the time, we'll not be able to see them overhead. They'll be, you know, flying by kissing the grass blades. So only you'll be able to see only part of the wing. So it is very important we show, I mean, we look closely, especially in order to identify the harriers, especially if they are females. Moving to the harriers, juveniles. Again, pied harrier juvenile is very distinct, you know, a very rusty bird. Doing a very quick time check. Okay, it's 10. Okay. I have, you know, few more slides to cover.
You have time. You can go ahead.
Okay. So pied harrier, again, a very rusty bird. You'll not be able to, pied harrier juvenile, you'll not be able to misidentify it for any other raptor. It is rusty as, you know, rusty as, you know, a brownish, reddish color. And compared to the other juvenile harriers, it is darker. Okay. And Montagu harrier and pallid harrier, juveniles are the ones which show orangish overall plumage. Other harriers don't show this kind of orangish plumage. So when you see a very orangish harrier, it could be one of the juveniles of Montagu's harrier or a pallid harrier. Again, one feature it is common between the female Montagu's and the pallid are the collar. So the pallid shows a very, very prominent and thick collar, wherein the Montagu's juvenile does not show a prominent collar. And the other feature that puts them apart is pallid harrier, the outer primaries are barred, wherein in the Montagu harrier, the outer primaries are all dark. So we'll be able to identify them based on this as well. And also, if you see, this entire secondaries are very, very, very dark for both the juvenile as well as juvenile Montagu as well as the pallid harrier. And the other thing that we can look at in field, especially in identifying a pallid as well as Montagu harriers, are Montagu harriers mostly feed on insects, wherein pallid harriers, they have a varied diet. They feed on birds as well as rodents, and as well as they constitute insects as well. Since Montagu's harriers feeds mostly on insects, they have a very lethargic and very slow flight, wherein the pallid harriers, as they have the tendency to hunt rodents as well as birds, they are very, very agile. So you know, once you observe them in the field, you'll be able to distinguish them just by the speed of the flight, you know, whether it is a Montagu harrier or a pallid harrier up to certain extent. There comes the Western marsh harrier. This is very straightforward. We will not miss them for mix them with any other harriers. The male are, you know, very pale. Again, when you compare it with other male harriers, even including the Eastern marsh harrier as well as the hen harrier, the male always show the hand of the males. The outer primaries of the males are always dark. This is a male Western marsh harrier. And again, the female Western marsh harrier is very distinct, you know, overall dark brown, chocolate brown, and a very diagnostic head as well as a lower chin patch, which is very, very pale. Moving on, the interesting part, the accipiters. The commonly encountered accipiters of our region are the sparrowhawk, the Eurasian sparrowhawk, as well as the shikra. And most of the time, you know, we see them, you know, gliding or fluttering overhead. And they pretty much look very similar, but then there are features through which we'll be able to distinguish them. First, we'll look at the males of Eurasian sparrowhawk as well as the shikra. Eurasian sparrowhawk, as you see, always show a bitonal head. They have a very dark gray head and then followed by a rusty cheeks, wherein shikras show a plain gray head. This is a very diagnostic feature where you can put these two to differentiate these two. And the other thing is the coverts, underwing coverts. The underwing coverts of Eurasian sparrowhawk are more rusty and you know, very thickly or densely barred. This is not a very this cannot be a very proper ID feature, but usually that is how the adult males look like. And the other thing that, you know, ID feature that we can look out is the number of protruding fingers. Okay, in Eurasian sparrowhawk, always, be it male, female, or juveniles, T5 to P10 are always visible. Primary 5 to primary 10, the 6 fingers are always visible. Wherein in shikra, again male, female, juvenile, only P6 to P5 are very conspicuous. Okay, and the fingers. Just by looking at that, and unless they are molting, see, if let's say if this particular Eurasian sparrowhawk is molting, the P5, it will be very short. You will not be able to identify it. Putting the, you know, different features together, overall, you know, stout or, you know, broad shouldered, broad breast, along with the head, along with the fingers, we put together, and a very longish tail, we put together, we'll be able to distinguish between a male Eurasian sparrowhawk and a shikra. Let's look at the female. This is a Eurasian sparrowhawk female. Again, there is one more feature that I missed to mention, are the gular stripe. It will not be visible always, but if it is visible, shikras show a gular stripe, wherein Eurasian sparrowhawks do not show a gullet stripe. So as you see in the picture below here, the female of the Shikra is showing a very distinct gullet stripe, wherein the Eurasian sparrowhawk do not show a gullet stripe. That is one feature. Again, you can see primary 5 to primary 10 very evenly visible, wherein here it is not, and it is very evenly barred brown, whereas it is very closely barred brownish gray. Again, in juveniles, the same thing. Juveniles show a very, very, very conspicuous gullet stripe, wherein it is missing in Eurasian sparrowhawk. Very long tail compared to that of Shikra, and a broad banding, wherein here the black bands are, slightly thinner. Again, you look at the wing panel, bulging secondaries for both, which shows the accipiter nature, wherein P5 to P6 are visible in Eurasian sparrowhawk, wherein it is not here. As you can see here, these two, P4 and P5 are actually molting. That's why they look shorter. But then if you look at P5, P6 to 10, they are pretty much visible. So by putting together these features, looking at the bicolored head, and then looking at the overall structure, the length of the tail and the fingers, and also the absence and presence of gullet stripe, we'll be able to identify whether it is a sparrowhawk or a Shikra. Now coming to the interesting part, the Aquila eagles. I'm going to just cover the mostly occurring two Aquila eagles, the Indian spotted eagle and the greater spotted eagle. So these are black kite plus size birds, and you can see the diagnostic rectangular wing panel and not so long tail, and a diagnostic protruding head. Okay, how do we put these differentiate these two? So the first one to look at is the gape line. For Indian spotted eagles, show a very, very fleshy yellow gape line, which actually extends beyond their eye line. So it extends very, very long gape line, wherein in the greater spotted eagle, very short gape line, which stops right at the middle of the eye. Along with that, you also look at the wing panel. So the wing panel of the Indian spotted eagle is very narrow or thinner, wherein the greater spotted eagle has a very broad wing panel. And the other thing to observe are the barring in the secondaries as well as the inner primaries. Indian spotted eagle, always being the juvenile or the adults, they always show evenly barred secondaries and inner primaries, wherein most of the time in greater spotted eagle, it is plain. And the other thing to observe is the contrast between the flight feathers as well as the coverts. Most of the time, Indian spotted eagle, the coverts are either pale.
GK, you seem to have lost your audio.
Coverts are always darker.
So when we lost your video about 10 seconds ago.
Is it okay now?
Yeah, it is better now. I think it's when you were talking about the wing panels.
Okay. So, I got a call and then, it got cut. Sorry about that. So, while talking about the wing panel, I'll quickly repeat. So, in the Indian spotted eagle, the secondaries as well as the inner primaries show banding. That is, very, 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 be it juveniles or adults, they'll show barrings in secondaries as well as the inner primaries, wherein that will be missing in most of the greater spotted eagles. Other thing to observe are the coverts. In greater spotted eagle, the coverts are always darker compared to that of the, you'll be able to see the contrast between the flight feathers as well as the coverts. Wherein in Indian spotted eagle, the coverts are always paler or equally darker, and there you'll not be able to see the contrast. So by putting these together, you'll be able to distinguish between the Indian spotted eagle and the greater spotted eagle. I mean, the field guides always also talk about the number of fingers, but if they are molting, we will not be able to go with the number of fingers, so I am not covering that. And coming to the toughest ones of our talk, the Bootios. it is very, very, very difficult for us to put, you know, identify the right boot use, especially, you know, when they are in flight. But then there are a few things, you know, that we can try in order to understand the commonly occurring two of the boot use of South India, the common boot use, I mean, the common buzzard as well as the long leg buzzard. Boot use actually, you know, have a very distinct feature, which is the darker corpus. So the other birds that show the darker corpus are, you know, possibly the Bonalese eagle will show it. And then, you know, some plumages of Rufous bellied eagle show it. And also, I think, honey buzzards, European honey buzzards show it. Otherwise, this is a very diagnostic feature of a boot use. So when you see a very darker carpal patch and bulging secondaries with a compact shape of the overall bird with not so long tail, it is going to be one of the boot use. So on the left is the common buzzard and the right is a long leg buzzard. They look very much similar in appearance. Also, they come in variable plumages. So it is very difficult for us to identify. But there are few things that we can observe are common buzzard always has a smaller head as well as a very weak beak, wherein the long leg buzzard has a very, very strong head with a very strong beak. This will not be very diagnostic in the field, but those are pointers with which we'll be able to put together if we see a typical you know, plumaged bird. And also, if you look at the tail, long leg buzzards show a rusty tail always with a, you know, sometimes it show a finer barring. But always the typical long leg buzzard show a rusty tail, wherein the common buzzard show a gray tail, again with or without barring. The other thing that we can also see is the length of the feathers, you know, the length of the wing panel. Common buzzards have a very compact and shorter wing panel, wherein long leg buzzards have very long, you know, wing panel. And one more thing that, you know, we can see when they are perched or the length of the, you know, tarsi. Usually the long leg buzzard, as the name suggests, you know, they show a very long legs along with the feathered tarsi, where in common buzzard, you know, they have a very short legs. So, you know, what I've covered so far are the, you know, the commonly occurring species in southern India, and what I had not covered are the vultures and the fish eagles, you know, considering the time in mind. That comes, you know, to my end of the talk. I wanted to check, you know, we will just quickly go through, you know, some of the very diagnostic plumages of different bird species and see if we can, you know, identify them with whatever the pointers that I had mentioned. So it will be, you know, I have three different bird species, three different slides here, which we'll try to identify as a quiz. So you can look at this bird, you know, observe the tail, and you can put your answers over in the chat, and we can discuss it once the answers are in.
So I've opened up the chat for everyone, guys. So please type in your answers.
Perfect. So how do I see the chat, Shrikant? Can you just read it out?
It is open.
Okay, I can see. Okay, I don't. Okay, I'm getting the answer. Okay. Yeah, most of them are got it right. It is a Oriental honey buzzard.
But.
Yes, Shrikant, go ahead.
No, please go ahead. Sorry.
Okay. So it's an Oriental honey buzzard. As you can clearly see from the tail, you know, dark subterminal band and a gray band, which is twice the size of the dark subterminal band. And also you can see the, you know, length of the feet. It ends right at the start of the tail. Wherein in crested hawk eagles, as I already mentioned, it comes till the, you know, middle of the tail. Okay, let's move on to the next one. Okay, sorry about that. Okay, here you go. Let's see how many get this right. Okay. Fantastic. You're getting all the right answers.
Yes.
Okay. So it's a great-eyed spotted eagle. As you can see, it is an aquila by the overall structure. And then you also see a lot of spots, you know, as in the greater as well as Indian spotted eagle. And you see the gape line, which is not extending beyond the middle of the eye. And also you see the contrast between the flight feathers as well as the coverts, and the coverts are darker. Let me go to the next one. Perfect.
Correct.
Got everything right. Yep. Yeah, one STSC, okay.
Montego slash palette.
Okay. We'll wait for 10 more seconds and see if there are any responses. Montego, okay. Okay. So it is actually, this is a pied harrier female. As you can clearly see, the trailing edge is actually going. It stops here because, you know, these two feathers are actually molting. So basically it is going all the way and it has a barred outer primaries. And you can put out Montagues and pallid harriers away just by looking at the primary base and the inner secondaries. As you can see in Montagues and pallid harrier, you'll see a very, very, very dark conspicuous banding when it is missing. And also, you know, since I covered most of it on the underwing, I did not pay attention to the upper wing. It also shows, the pallid harrier female shows a diagnostic white rump followed by a all gray tail with a evenly barred black tail banding. And the primary base, the base of the primaries in the upper wing panel is always gray. So with that, we'll be able to identify it. It is not as distinct in Montagues as well, or the pallid harrier.
Pallid.
Yeah. Okay, just give me a minute. Okay, that brings me to the finishing of the talk. And thanks for soaring along and be a raptor file. And watch more raptors, observe them, and then also document them. Happy raptor watching.
Thank you, GK. That was actually a wonderful gift you have given us on your birthday. It was really indeed a great pleasure for us to hear your talk today. We are opening up for questions, so everyone can post your questions on the chat publicly so that would pick up those questions. I have a couple of questions sent to me privately during the session. I would just like to start off with that. Number one, it's from Surekha from Deccan Birders. Is the shape of raptor's tail an indicator of its flight capability?
Sorry, can you repeat that, Shikhan?
Is the shape of raptor's tail an indicator of its flight capabilities?
Yes, it does. So, the wing along with the tail, together, helps the raptor soar. Say, for example, if you consider, short-toed snake eagle, they have very, very broad tail pan, which while it hovers, it fans out, which actually helps them while, helps in hovering. Not just the wings, it is actually the flight capabilities are combined with wing along with the tail. Yes.
Okay. So we have another question by Srika. Just a moment, please. Yeah, 90% of the diet of Lammergeier is bones. Now, with the increased absence of carcass, do they get enough of their diet, or have they changed their diet to adapt?
I am not very sure about that.
Okay. So, I mean, just if I may answer it, broader audience as well.
Yeah.
I mean, in the hills of Himalayas, finding the carcass is not difficult nowadays, but I mean, not nowadays, for a long time. Every other day, they do find a lot of carcass and Lammergeier to feed on. But Lammergeier is, there is evidence supporting the fact that Lammergeier or the bearded vulture hunts for its prey as well sometimes. So, yeah, this is just a trivia which I know. I learned about Lammergeier. So, Umesh, over to you for the questions on the chat.
Yeah, okay. okay, the first question is from Samrud Nandagopal. What is Aquila?
Aquilas, Aquilas are, it is one of the family of eagles. Indian spotted eagle, greater spotted eagle, steppe, as well as tawny. These come under, Aquila eagles.
Right. Okay, a question from Ritesh. How do we differentiate steppe from GSC?
Okay, how to differentiate steppe from GSC? Okay, in flight, GSC is a very, very, very bulky bird. Okay, overall, it has a very, very long wing panel. And if you are able to see the gape, steppe eagles show a very, very long gape, which extends beyond their eyes, wherein greater spotted eagle shows a gape which is very, very, very short, as well as overall size itself, you'll be able to make it out. The structure also, the steppe are very, very, very bulky. And those in flight, those are the diagnostic features that I can quote.
Right. Okay, the next question is from Mujib. Does the booted eagle have a terminal band in the tail?
Yes, it does. It is not very distinct as in other raptors. The gray tail will have a very, very thin band, which not most of the eagles show. But if the tail is all spread, some of the specimens, you'll be able to see the terminal band. But it is not very distinct as in Bonelli's eagle or other eagles.
Right. Okay. Question from Dr. Muvendan. Whether raptor group is decreasing or increasing in India, generally speaking, or does it vary from species to species?
It is a very, very tough question. So, currently, if you see overall birding as well as bird photography are increased a lot. So we started seeing people have started posting a lot the numbers have grown up. Right. So raptors being very special to most of us. And people go behind raptors, and then there are lots of sightings that are coming up. But overall population, I think I would quote, we have to wait for, State of Indian Birds guys to come up with, they already started releasing for each species, whether what is the trend. So I would say we will wait for them to release for raptors, because they have done a data analysis with historical data as well as the current data from eBird.
Right. Okay, a question from Lakshmi. How do we participate in the raptor watching projects organized by MNS or Deccan Birders? I can probably answer this on your behalf.
Yes.
Projects are announced to all the members in both the groups. So, I would just request all of you to volunteer and participate wholeheartedly whenever these projects are announced.
You drop in your email.
Okay, the next question is from Ravikant. Do the raptors regulate population of ruminants?
Sorry, can you repeat that, Umesh?
Do raptors regulate the population of ruminants?
What does that mean?
Would you like? I think let's ask Ravi to unmute himself and explain or elaborate more on the question. Srikanth?
Yeah, I will.
Can you unmute Ravikant?
Ravikant. Yeah, I think he's asking more of the.
They can unmute themselves, right?
Or, you know.
Ravikant, are you there?
Yeah, I'm here.
Yeah, please ask your question. Elaborate your question.
Ruminants means herbivores, like mountain goats or any other ungulates, no, like deer, spotted deer, especially some or other any.
Oh, ungulates. Okay. Okay. So, not very much. Crested hawk eagles and hawk eagles as well as legs eagle have been observed eating the carcass of spotted as well as sambar deer. But those are
I mean just live animals, no, they are able to capture or not. In Mukurt National Park, I have seen Nilgirtar lamb captured by some eagle, but I don't know which eagle that time in 2010, I'm saying.
Okay. It could possibly what I can think of is it could possibly be a Bonalese eagle. But yeah, Bonalese eagles are very strong. You know, they always capture, they are capable of capturing prey animals which are much, much bigger as well as heavier than their size. Okay. And one thing that I can quote is, some of the Hyderabad groups, they have got Bonalese eagle hunting black buck fawn.
Thank you.
I think this was hunted in 2016. And
yes, it was captured in
Rolapadu.
Yeah, it was captured in Rolapadu, and wherein Bonalese was hunting a fawn of black buck, and it was captured live. I mean, the entire 1 hour saga, it was captured live.
Yeah. And adding to that, golden eagles are also capable of doing that. So there are multiple documentations of golden eagles, pushing away the mountain goats, from a steep rocky surface, and then when they get killed, they'll come down for consuming them.
Sir, right. One more question: is there any reference like raptors feeding on these ungulates, like small kids of ungulates or herbivores, whatever?
I don't have it handy. Probably we'll be able to, get it for you.
Oh, okay, thank you.
Yeah, we can circulate if you can share it with us later. We can circulate.
Thank you for your answer. Right.
Thanks.
The next question is from Claudia Ajike. Is there a size difference between the ISE and the GSE?
Size difference, it is not very distinct. See, raptors they show reverse sexual size dimorphism, right? So the males are smaller and the females are bigger. So we will not be able to distinguish them by size, because the females of Indian spotted eagles, I mean, definitely the GSE are bigger. But then there is the females of Indian spotted eagles maybe have an overlapping size with the males of greater spotted eagle. So with that, we will not be able to distinguish right by the size. It is not the right way. But then the other pointers that I mentioned, the gape line, as well as, when they are perched, it is easy, not just by the shape. They have a very spiky nape. The GSC have a very spiky nape, as well as habitually GSC prefers and stays very close to the wetlands, as they hunt mostly on toads, frogs, as well as consumes the water birds. They tend to stay very close to the wetlands. Wherein the Indian spotted eagle, they prefer a variety of habitat and they are widespread. And the other thing that I can quote is the overall head itself. The head of the greater spotted eagle is much, much bulkier and stronger, whereas in the Indian spotted eagle, it is more rounded.
Okay, great. Next question is from Varun. What exactly is the correct time of the day to watch out for raptors in the sky?
As I already mentioned, what raptor you're going to watch is the first question. Okay, if it is going to be falcons, you have to be as early harriers. You have to be as early as possible, because they are very early risers, and also they hunt very early in the morning. And some of them, like Eurasian hobby, and then red-necked falcon, these are very much crepuscular. once the sun comes out, they'll just go and hide somewhere, and they are very much crepuscular. And so if you want to watch falcons as well as harriers, you have to be as early as possible. And if you want to watch the bigger raptors and eagles, as they come out, as they use thermals for soaring, most of the time they'll come out only during the proper daytime once the sun comes out. So as the day progresses, bigger eagles come into the field.
Right. Okay, question from JVD Murthy. Doesn't the plumage change with raptors as they age?
Okay, the plumage change in the aspect of, yes, so they mold. All the raptors mold year on year, right? So their plumage changes while they were molting. Especially most of the raptors, the juveniles will look completely different compared to the adults. But then, unlike the terns and gulls, wherein, during the breeding, as well as the waders, they have, plumes and other things during the breeding, wherein the entire bird changes color as well as feathers. So that will not happen. But then the plumage variation is with individuals, as well as whether it is a juvenile or subadult or an adult.
Right. Okay.
There are a couple of questions to me as well, Umesh, if you have some more.
Sorry?
There are a couple of questions sent to me as well, privately.
Shall we finish off this chat first?
Yeah, exactly.
Okay, I'm just scrolling down, just one second. Okay, there's a question from Mujib. Do you post the video of the session on YouTube? Yes, we do. Yes. I think Srikanth has shared the link for the YouTube channel earlier. Srikanth, maybe we can just post it once more.
Yeah, Satvik just posted, I'm just posting.
Satvik has just posted. Okay, that's fine. Okay, there's a question from B Link. I'm not sure who this is. Did I miss a comparison between tawny and steppy?
Okay, I didn't have it in the presentation for considering time in mind. So again, tawny and steppy, you'll be able to distinguish them based on the gape plane as well as the overall wing panel, wherein the tawny, the wing panel is much narrower, wherein for steppy, it is very, very wide. And
okay, there's a request for a session on owls.
Ritesh, I suppose.
Okay, I think we're done with questions on the chat as of now. Srikanth, you can ask those questions which you had received.
Yes, please. Hi, there is a question from Vignesh. How could you share some info on possibility of hybrids? So just to add on to this question.
Can you repeat that, Srikanth? I didn't catch that.
Could you share some info on possibility of hybrids?
Hybrids. Okay.
Just to add to this question, GK, there are recent sightings of Oriental honey buzzard and European honey buzzard hybrid. Right? So the first image which you showed during the quiz, so how could we eliminate the European honey buzzard? Just in case, if you may.
Yeah, definitely. So first thing on hybrids, there are hybrids that are occurring, especially where, in terms of residents, I don't remember, reading any about any hybrids, but there are migrants wherein I have known about hybrids are, especially in terms of harriers, okay, wherein the Western and the Eastern Marsh Harrier hybrids do exist, wherein the the males show the diagnostic marks of both Western as well as the Eastern Marsh males. And also there are hybrids, as I already mentioned, the common kestrel, with a pale claw, that could be a hybrid, where there are places where two different species breed together. There are possibilities of hybrid. And one good example that you mentioned, Srikanth, is on the hybridization of the European honey buzzard versus the Oriental honey buzzard. Okay. So, honey buzzards, picking European honey buzzard and the Oriental honey buzzard is again very tricky. There are few pointers that have been mentioned, which are the European honey buzzard shows a very, very, very dark carpal patch, which will be missing in a Oriental honey buzzards. And there was a specimen which was been identified as oriental anipasa, which still showed a dark carpel, which actually turned out to be a hybrid. And along with that, the tail and wing pattern that I was mentioning, right? That also is very much in European anipasa, the tail pattern of the subterminal band followed by a gray band and followed by another band, a black band, which matches exactly with the wing panel as well, wherein there will be subtle differences in the oriental anipasa. And the other thing that I also mentioned is the gorget. So which will be completely missing in the European anipasa, wherein it is very distinct in oriental anipasa. Those are some of the pointers. There are more pointers, I think there are a few experts who had shared it. And there are a few papers out there in online that people can verify and refer.
True. And there was one other question. Just a moment, please. Of course, there are many questions where people have been asking. People have been praising about the talk, and it was indeed a great talk for all of us.
Thank you so much.
One second. Yeah, Ms. Devika Rani has a question. Red kite, black kite, major differences. Please share info if there are any, if there are red kite sightings in India.
Red kites, within the subcontinent, there are, some, if I remember right, in Russian Neurology, I see, in India, some of the, there were markings of a few individuals of red kites.
I think the western side.
Yeah, probably in the western side.
Yeah.
So, but then I think red kites are much bigger than our black kites. They look more like our Brahmini kites, without that white, underbelly. So.
Yes.
And also, I think that their tail, if I remember right, their tail are also very diagnostic, rusty brown.
True. Correct. And there are very old records of possible red kites in India, but again, lack of sufficient evidence is something to look for, I would say. Yes. So, Umesh, there are a few more questions for you on the chat, please.
Yeah. Are you done with the questions you had received directly?
Yes, I had only two.
Okay. So, a couple of more questions on the chat, GK. Any possibility of a hybrid Besra with Shikra? Because juvenile Shikra seem to be very similar to Besra. This is a question from Mujib.
No, it is very hard to say that whether they are hybrid. If the question is on the Shikra as well as the Besra juveniles looks pretty much similar. That's their adaptation. But I don't know whether there are hybrids out there. If others can quote.
Okay. Okay. A question from Sudhir. What is the key diagnostic ID feature to differentiate crested hawk eagle from legless hawk eagle?
Okay, so crested hawk eagles, they are very slender birds. To be honest, legless hawk eagles are much bulky. The other diagnostic feature is the barring instead of the streaking. If you look close by, the crested hawk eagles have streakings, bold streakings. Wherein the legless hawk eagles, it will be the horizontal bars. So that is one of the diagnostic feature that I can,
Okay. I think that is it on the chat. I have received a request from Rajshekhar. He'd like to ask you a question directly. Rajshekhar, can you please unmute yourself and ask your question?
Yes, already done, sir.
Yeah, please.
Gyanskandan, your talk is fabulous.
Thank you.
At the outset, my quick question is, among these raptors, so around the airports, black cats are persecuted for bird hits and also the vultures. And around the airport areas, the raptors are the most persecuted species. So then my quick question is, what are the conservation measures taken around the airport area so that the pressure is taken down from these raptors? This is my question.
Yeah, across worldwide, the way that they control the birds that are, flying around, be it the black cats or other birds that fly around the airport area is by trained falcons. Okay, One way, there are two reasons where black aids, you know, come into the airport runways, things like that, is availability of the garbage or feeding some feeds. Okay, so they people will make sure that there are airports, they want to keep their runways and other things out of garbage. That is the first thing. The second thing what they are doing is, as I mentioned, they are training falcons as the watchdogs, and there are multiple airports wherein they have trained falcons, wherein they they fly them on a very regular basis in order to keep away any birds, including the kites, any birds that fly along the runway.
Now, are we doing it in India? I don't think so. We are doing it in India.
No, we are not doing it in India.
No, because I have observed it's been practiced in Toronto Airport and Montreal Airport and those parts, right? Not in India.
There was some proposal which was going on. If I remember right, especially in Chennai, there were some talks going on in order to get some trained falcons from somewhere from Dubai or something like that, and then try it out. This has not been tried in India, right? So they wanted to try it, but that has been put down for various reasons.
The reason for asking this question is because I have written conservation plans for 13 airports in India, including greenfield airports.
Okay.
So then even the raptor conservation is one of my key point in the reports. So that I'm avoiding the bird hit areas. So I wanted to draw the insights from you. That's why it is not for say's sake I asked the question.
Yeah, I got that, sir. Thank you so much.
Thank you very much. I appreciate your talk.
Thank you.
Okay, last question. Shweta has a question. Shweta, can you please unmute yourself?
So it's not a question, but I would like to really appreciate the class, because I have attended n number of webinar classes wherein they talk about what work they have done, but they never ever gave us description the way a GK sir has done. I think this is what I was looking for from, I think it's been like 2 months, I think I'm attending so many webinar classes. For us to learn, it is more important for us to identify things and how we can do. Okay, so I think this was a fabulous class out of all the classes what I have attended. I think make sure when we have other webinar classes, such things are going to be part of it, because just talking about something will not really make us work towards it. Maybe we can become a volunteer, or we can just be doing a work, but we can't identify. There's no point in learning something. I think the way he has explained us about every raptor was really nice. I'm really glad I joined in the middle, because I had another class which I was attending. But the moment I got, I just, came in and I was listening to it. Thank you so much, Mr. GK. It was really, really nice. I think this is what we are looking out for, because everybody who attend this class doesn't have to be a professional who knows about these things. So when you have the little things, what you talk about, identification, how you can do, that will, make us have more interest towards them. Maybe we can become a good, it's not compulsory that I can be a conservationist, but at least educate other people around them. Differentiation, I can teach in my way, on my own way.
Exactly.
I'm really, really thankful, Mr. GK. And I really want to learn a lot about these birds, because I'm not a bird person at all. But I really want to learn. If it's possible, sir, if you can give me your email address, I would really want to be in touch with you so that I can learn. I'm a layman, but but I really want to learn about wildlife.
Yeah. Probably I'll put... okay. Numesh, will you be able to put my... email address there.
We'll do.
Thanks for that comment,
Shweta. That was fantastic feedback. Thank you so much. Very, very happy to hear that these sessions are useful. And GK, of course, has done a brilliant job in the presentation.
And the time was very, very short. I can talk for continuously even for a day. you also wanted to share more. There are multiple things. I even wanted to talk about each of the species, their specialties and things like that, but time constraint, probably off a day session in the future.
Yeah, we will really look forward for that, sir.
Thank you.
Yes, GK.
Okay, I just put GK's mail ID on the chat.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Thank you the whole panel who has given us this great opportunity to attend this fabulous webinar. And special thanks to Mr. GK. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much.
Thank you, Shweta. I think that is it as far as questions are concerned.
So thank you. I think, Umesh, thank you for organizing this talk with GK. And we would definitely forward for another session from GK. Again, you need to make this happen for all of us. Like Shweta said, a half day marathon would be good.
GK. Definitely. I'm always for it, Shikant.
yes. And Shweta, I mean, thank you for your kind words, Shweta, especially because it kind of helps us to innovate these sessions, make these more interesting to the listeners. So actually, your words actually help us to even more organize even more sessions like these. So
yes,
thank you so much for that.
And welcome, sir. Because see, when as a layman, I understand what I look for. You people are experts and you know everything about it. Maybe you won't look at from the point of people who are starting to learn about it. So I thought it will be a great help for everybody.
That was a very well thought answer, or rather I would say a statement by you. Yes.
Once again, thanks everybody.
Thank you. And we thank all the participants who have joined us today. Thank you very much, guys. Please join, subscribe for our YouTube channel. There you can find all the information on all the talks. Going forward, we'll be putting even our future talks there. And we have a lot.
Thank you so much, Srikant, Dumesh, and others. You know, of Deccan Borders. I cannot, expect a better birthday. Gift than this. Being in a quarantine time, being in the lockdown. I definitely cannot expect, much more than this.
Thank you, GK.
That is very kind of you to say, GK.
Very kind of you, very nice of you.
Completely enjoyed it. Yeah.
And Srikant, Umesh, may I make a request? Can you please post? Thank you, Srikant, you've done it. There's inquiries about this.
Yeah.
Yes.
So please post the link once again.
Right.
And maybe sometime in future, we should have GK back again with a different aspect to Raptors.
Definitely. Yes. Oh, yes. Definitely, we will. I also wanted to mention, why the
specific groups as well. Yeah.
Sorry. Yeah, yeah. I also wanted to mention, since although the link has been posted there, some people have been saying that there have been issues with connecting. So I think they've missed out bits and pieces in between. I'll request all these people to go to the channel and watch the talk all over again. I think Shweta, you also mentioned that you missed the beginning. I think that's a good way to catch up.
Yeah, lots of people could not log in. I just got a call from Shafat Bhai.
Right.
Saying that he was unable to log in. And I said, why? You should have immediately told me. I could have informed Srikant and we could have put you in.
Hmm.
So obviously he didn't do that. But then I told him it's been recorded and it's available on the channel. The recording is available.
In fact, I also feel that, this is the kind of session where I think it will help us to go over this once more, at least once or twice more. Because those features, there's so much of, wealth of information, and I don't know how much of it you can absorb at the first go. So, I think it's worth running over it once more. I think it's a great reference to look at.
Yes.
All the species which he has noted, he has given a proper field guide to us. GK, I think most of us amateurs who are trying to learn more about these birds, I think this is a good field guide for us in Raptors.
Thank you so much for the commercial.
Yeah, I agree with you.
Yeah, and GK, what you have done is also told me that I must improve my typing skills. By the time I typed in my answer, I was about to click enter, the others had given two. I got two out of the three right. I'm very slow with my typing because I have a hunt and peck kind of a typist.
Yeah, and probably from next time, I will be careful in getting, much more challenging, photographs, than this time.
yes.
And also, there were some of them who were asking for the kills, raptor killing angles and other things. So I will gather the information from some of our members who have shot the entire series. Probably, if there is a video available, attach the video on our YouTube channel so you can view it there.
Right.
Yeah. Right, guys. So, yes.
Okay, I think thank you. Kind of done.
Thank you, everyone. Thanks for joining us. Thank you, Umesh. Thank you, GK. You are our special guest. And of course, it is your birthday. So happy birthday again from all of us at Deccan Birders. And
Thank you so much, guys.
Yeah. And thank you, JVD, sir, for bringing up such initiatives forward for us.
But it all, Shrikant, the credit should go to GK for all this.
Yes, true.
Now I'm ready to take on any raptor you show me.
Okay. Now that you've said it, he's going to come up with some pictures. Which are
good. We'll do it in the field, sir, very soon.
Let's hope so.
Yeah, we'll do that.
Yeah.
Look forward to that. Right. Enjoy your day.
Thank you, sir.
Bye-bye. Thanks, everybody. Bye. GK, happy birthday once again. Enjoy.
Thanks, GK. Happy birthday.
Thank you. Bye-bye.
Fantastic session.
Thank you.